Good morning. Why don't you stand with us? Let's sing as we gather together this morning.
This is my Father's world. Into my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, this and the wondrous world. Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their maker's praise. This is my Father's world, he shines in all that's fair, in the rustling grass I hear him pass, speaks to me everywhere. So in one, should I worry? In whom should I fear? For I know that you are with me, and I know that you are near. You are love, steadfast love, faithful love, and I know that you are near. Father's word, oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems oh so strong, God is ruler yet. This is my Father's word, the battle is not done, but Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. So in one, should I worry? In whom should I fear? For I know that you are with me, and I know that you are near. You are love, steadfast love, faithful love, and I know that you are near. You are love, steadfast love, faithful love, and I know that you are near, and I know that you are near. This is my Father's world, dreaming I see his face. I open my eyes in glad surprise, cause the Lord is in this place. This is my Father's world, from shining courts above, the beloved one, his only son, can pledge of deathless love. The beloved one, his only son, came a pledge of deathless love. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Good
morning.
Guys, come on. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a lot better. You can be seated. Welcome to Northside Community Church. Glad that you're here this morning. I know it's cold outside, but thankful that you're here. Thankful that you're in a warm place. Thankful that we've gathered in this place to worship. I want to just do a couple things this morning before we get started. I want to open up in a word of prayer. This is the first Sunday of Advent, and going to be inviting Tim and Kim Young to come and to read the Advent reading for us this morning and to light the Advent candle, the candle of hope. You're going to be hearing about that this morning. But thankful that you're here, I'm going to invite you to have a word of prayer with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gift of this day, for the blessing of life, for all that you do for us. And Lord, as we come here, we do so on the heels of a holiday in which many of us were going from one place to another. Some were battling sickness and illness. Some were having to spend the holidays with loved ones who were ill. But Lord, we collectively as a group of people celebrated Thanksgiving. And Father, however that found us, whether with our families or in sickness or with those who are suffering, Lord, we're still thankful people. Lord, as we gather here, we ask for your blessing on this time. We pray that in every way, the heart of Thanksgiving that was found on Thursday would be brought into this place, and that the songs we sing, the prayers we pray, the words we read in Scripture, Father, that all of it would come from a wellspring of thankfulness in our lives. Lord, you do so much for us. You have sent your only Son for us. And God, it's today that we gather to thank you and to worship him. May we do so in spirit and in truth for all that you've done for us. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Amen. If you are new to Northside, we certainly want to welcome you today. We recognize Thanksgiving holiday. A lot of people are traveling. But if you're visiting with us, in the bulletin is a Connect card. If you're comfortable filling that out, you can drop it in the offering bag a little later on in the service. Or if you have prayer concerns, you can share those concerns with us, and we'll definitely be keeping them in our prayers this coming week. It is the first Sunday of Advent, and I'm going to invite Tim and Kim to come and to read about the candle of hope and to light that for us this morning.
This is Advent. Come listen to God's promise. The Lord will settle arguments between nations. They will pound their swords and their spears into rakes and shovels. They will never make war or attack one another. People of Israel, let us live by the light of the Lord. Isaiah 2:4-5.
This is Advent. Come listen to God's promise of a world where violence is no more, where people gather to worship God and celebrate what unites rather than what divides. Let us follow God's way of hope. The candle's light reminds us that Christ came to bring hope to nations and people worn out by war, to families striving to raise God-honoring children, to communities dulled by violence. Its light reminds us that there is another way, a better way. This is the candle of hope.
Our Old Testament reading, Psalms 31:21-24. Praise the Lord, for he has shown me the wonders of his unfailing love. He kept me safe when my city was under attack. In panic, I cried out, I am cut off from the Lord. But you heard my cry for mercy and answered my call for help. Love the Lord, all you godly ones. For the Lord protects those who are loyal to him, but he harshly punishes the arrogant. So be strong and courageous, all you who put your hope in the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand with us. Let's sing together this morning.
Come.
are age to age the same. Jesus, faithful is your name and true. So until the sun does rise, till your trumpets ring the skies, help us keep our restless eyes on you. Jesus, Son of God, so full of grace and truth, the Father, saving word, so wonderful in you. The angels long to see, and prophets search to find, the glory we have seen revealed, you shine. Living as last one of us under the shadow of the cross. Where through the blood you shed, you have made peace again. Peaceful world that God so loves. So sing along. Oh, light of the world, light of the world, light of the world, you shine upon us. Light of the world, light of the world, light of the world, you shine upon us. So full of grace and truth, so full of grace and truth, the light of the world, light of the world,
gospel reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, from chapter 12. Look at my servant, whom I have chosen. He is my beloved, who pleases me. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will proclaim justice to the nations. He will not fight or shout or raise his voice in public. He will not crush the weakest reed or put out a flickering candle. Finally, he will cause justice to be victorious, and his name will be the hope of all the world. Word of God for us this morning. Thanks be to God. I invite you to be seated.
My hope is built on nothing less. In Jesus' blood and righteousness, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that verse again together.
My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, a cornerstone, weak made strong in the fire. Love is through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest in his unchanging grace. In every high stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm. the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, just in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
Let's sing that chorus together. In Christ alone.
Christ alone, the cornerstone, weak made strong, the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Father, we profess Your Lordship this morning as a people who have been called by Your name and set apart, that we might experience Your love, Your restoration, Your hope, Your faith, Your purpose. And God, as we celebrate this time and season of Advent, may we look forward knowing that You have given us all hope, that You restore our lives even now. Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters who are sick this morning. Pray that You would bring restoration to their bodies, healing and wholeness. To the families that are affected by those sicknesses, God, we lift them up to You. Pray that You would give them endurance. Or for our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted this morning, in whatever way, we pray that You would bring freedom and perseverance through that time, that they may know Your goodness. Lord, we lift up Bill this morning as he brings us Your word. Lord, I pray that as we hear it, and what is spoken and what goes unspoken, that You would change us, that You would transform us by the renewing of our minds, that we would not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed. Lord, we love You and pray that You'd be glorified in our time together, that You'd make us one as You were one. We pray these things through Your Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus, and all the church said, amen.
Well, it's great to be back with you, and just want to say a quick word of thanks. This past week was a busy week in the life of our church. We had a worship last Sunday, and really thankful for Joe Pritchett and his willingness to be here, and I really appreciate the kind words so many of you had to say about the message that Joe shared, and Shoshana and I were able to watch from our hospital room and really appreciated Joe's message on being thankful, and then my thanks to David Wiggs and our elders for covering Sunday night, the congregational meeting. Tuesday night, Dan and Eric were here for the community Thanksgiving service. And Glenn and Mitch, Thursday during the Thanksgiving Day outreach. So if you're a pastor and you had to pick one week in the life of the church to miss, it was last week. And but I really do appreciate your prayers and prayers for Shoshana and our new addition, Graham. It was an unusual delivery and in a lot of ways, and so we're really appreciative of your prayers and your ongoing prayers for all of us as we adjust to his new schedule in our lives. Really thankful that Bill Powell is willing to share with us this morning. If you don't know Bill, he is an elder here at Northside, and I'm sure you know that about him, but there might be some other things that you don't know about Bill. He is a huge Ohio State fan, so he is in a very good mood this morning. But more importantly, Bill served as a pastor of several Free Methodist churches for many years, and is most recently an LPC, a licensed professional counselor, spending most of his time counseling veterans who are dealing with PTSD in a practice near Lillington. He has been a great counsel to me in my life. As an older pastor to a somewhat younger pastor, he's been such an encouragement to me and has really been a blessing to our church. And so thankful that he's willing to share this morning. Before he comes up, going to invite Lainey Mathis to come and to read the passages of Scripture for us this morning.
Romans 8:22-26. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. And not only that, but we ourselves, who have the Spirit as the first fruits, we also groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. Now in this hope we were saved, yet hope that is seen is not hope, because who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patience. In the same way, the Spirit also joins to help in our weakness, because we do not know what to pray for as we should. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with unspoken groanings.
Thanks, Lainey.
Okay. Some of you may know that I had an incident with an infection at Easter this last year, and overall, I'm pretty much recovered, except my legs will not let me stand more than a few minutes, so I'm going to have to sit today again. It's one of those things that it'll have to work itself out, I guess. To begin with, when Adrian asked me to preach this morning, and he said that the topic was going to be hope, I was sort of confused because I wasn't real sure what hope had to do with the church. And many of you may not understand, but Mr. Hope is from, he was originally born somewhere else, but he came to Ohio and spent most of his life in Ohio. And so the only time I got to go to Ohio State to see a football game, they do a thing called Script Ohio, where they write out Ohio in script. And then the tuba, one of the sousaphone players, gets to dot the I. And the day I was there, Bob Hope was taken out with a sousa player, and he got to dot the I. The only time I ever saw Bob Hope, and the only time I ever saw Ohio State play in person, but it was a thrill nonetheless to see Bob Hope. Now, for those of you who are very, very young, I also threw in a picture for you in case you didn't know who Bob Hope was. You certainly know who Hope Solo is. Just in case. I didn't want to leave you all out either, because many of you are too young to recognize the references that you have. One of the problems with being 63 and being a counselor and having lots of 15-year-olds in your office is when I make a joke, most of the time they have no idea what I'm talking about, because my jokes are based in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, and so therefore I kind of lose them. Today I want to talk about hope. But one of the places I really, really want to start is that we struggle in a society, and I see this in my office all the time, we struggle in a society where people are hopeless. I wouldn't have a job if it wasn't for hopelessness. Adrian probably wouldn't have a job as a chaplain if it wasn't for hopelessness. And so I wanted to look at where hopelessness is. It's at the corner of discouragement and hopelessness. And the clients that I have, they have lots of issues, but I thought maybe I would share my three issues that are most hopeless for me. The first is I struggle with my weight. The second is I'd love to have a new Camaro. And the third is the Cleveland Browns. Pretty hopeless in my life. Of course, that's not as hopeless as Michigan State fans. now, that's just plain hopeless, I think. All kidding aside, we have to understand. I saw one of my friends who is a pastor in Ohio, and he's a Penn State fan. He grew up in Pennsylvania. And one of the interesting things he wrote was, to all you folks who are Ohio State fans, all the promises you made in your prayers today, I expect to see you at church tomorrow because I'm sure that's what you said. What I want you to all understand is God does not care which team wins. You need to know that today. I'm just here to tell you, he doesn't care. It's a game. And he did not make the sky Carolina blue because he's a Carolina fan. And I guess they had a tough weekend too. Is that right? Yeah, yeah. So, you know, God doesn't care. We care, but God doesn't care. The title of today's sermon is Skipping Hope. Sort of like skipping rope, skipping hope. For some of you, you know I like puns, and so I was kind of playing around with that. One of my favorite books is a John Grisham book called Skipping Christmas. And if you have never read the book, you may want to get the book and read it between now and Christmas. It's a wonderful book, but if you're more into movies, you can watch the movie, which is not nearly as good as the book, I promise. And it's called Christmas with the Cranks. It's the same book. Sort of the gist of it is they decided Thanksgiving that they're going to forego Christmas and buy a trip to some desert island, and they were trying to get away, so they weren't going to decorate their homes and everything. And all their neighbors go crazy because they're not prepared for Christmas. The long and short of it is it all works out at the end. It's like a Hallmark movie in a way. It all works out in the end, and everything works out well. Today, I want to just kind of think about hopelessness in the Bible first. If you look at the Bible is full of hopeless stories. I mean, from the beginning of Genesis, it's a hopeless story. You have two people who are in the most beautiful place in the world, and they get cast out, and it's hopeless. We have two brothers who hate each other, and one of them kills the other, and so you only have one heir left, and it's hopeless. You have the children of Israel having spent a couple hundred years in Egypt, and they're slaves, and it's hopeless. And it's so hopeless that Moses tries to do something about it when he's a child of the Pharaoh's daughter, and he kills somebody, and he has to run away for 40 years or so just to hide so that they don't kill him. It's hopeless. He comes, and he takes the children of Israel out, and they get to the Red Sea, and the army of Egypt is about to kill them, and they're trapped, and it's hopeless. They get ready to go into the Promised Land, and the River Jordan's at flood stage. It's hopeless. We look at David when his son Absalom assumes the kingship, and it's so bad that he takes some of his concubines, David's concubines, up on the roof and has sex with him in front of everybody to prove that he's much superior to his father. And for David, it was hopeless. He mentioned a couple weeks ago about Elijah and the challenge with the prophets of Baal, and he ends up hiding in a cave someplace, and for him, it was hopeless. We have the nation of Israel, and they're a nation, yet they're in captivity by the Romans. And the Romans have got their heavy thumb on them, and the taxes are horrible, and everything's going wrong, and it's hopeless. And as we think about that, I think about people in my office, and I think about people I come in contact with every day. People who don't have a relationship with their kids. People who struggle with their parents. People who are dealing with alcoholism. People who are having nightmares, seeing memories of the things that they saw and were a party to when they were overseas as part of the military. People who have suffered great abuse. People whose lives appear to them seem hopeless. And I wanted to just kind of share from the book of Romans, because Romans is, for me, one of the more fascinating books in the Bible, and largely because of its literary style. It is probably the best picture of a point-counterpoint or a pros and cons kind of book that you're ever going to read. The first seven chapters are all the cons. The rest of the book is all the positives. And there's a fulcrum in the middle in which the whole thing teeter-totters. In the beginning, we have Paul gives us a whole litany of things that we need to kind of look at here. We're looking at the first chapter as he writes to the Romans. We're going to begin in 28 of the first chapter. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to depraved mind so that they do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossip, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful. They invent ways of doing evil, and they disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Although they know God's righteous decrees that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do them, these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. It's interesting that Romans chapter 1, for me, is the book, is the chapter that all the people who want to go after homosexuals use and whack them on the head, because the book sort of alludes to the fact that that's probably not the thing that should be done. And yet, Paul writes this list, and probably every one of us can pick at least one thing in that list that we are guilty of. I mean, you saw the picture of my car. I'd love to have a Camaro. Every time I see one, I'm like the kid in the old commercial for Jeep where the guy's going through Toys R Us and he goes, ooh. We all struggle with something in that list. And if you're not, you're in denial, and that'll help my practice as well, because we deal with people in denial as well. The point is that if we're truly honest, then the next verse is in chapter 2. The next verse is probably the most important verse in the book as far as setting this idea. You therefore have no excuse. You who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself because you pass judgment, do the same things. Wow. It's interesting. From this, I had a church that was largely people in recovery from drugs and alcohol. A very interesting church. It was not your mom and dad's church, and we played rock and roll on Sunday morning, and it was just really an unusual place. But one of the things we had to quit doing in this church was we quit having to have sort of an open prayer request time, because it became a gossip time. And I became strongly convicted that we needed to be very, very careful about how we gossiped about one another. And so we moved to just putting everybody's name on a slip of paper, and we had a little tiny wooden cross up front, and we would take those, and I would take a big thumbtack, and I'd stick it on there, and I would say, God knows what these are. God will take care of them. Because we have to be careful about what we do. We have to be careful of how we judge others. We have to be careful of all those things, because we're all prone to sin. That's part of the fall. And Paul suggests that we should not pass judgment on one another. We skip ahead a little bit to chapter 3. As is written, there is no righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Wow. It's pretty hopeless, isn't it? Pretty hopeless. We skip on down a little bit farther in chapter 3. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We skip to chapter 6. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Ooh, we got some hope. We got some hope. Sin is a struggle for all. And Paul says that we have an opportunity to not be bound by that sin. It's a free gift. When we become a Christian, we're no longer bound by the cost of that gift. We're free to live a life that is righteous. But chapter 7 is the great puzzle. Chapter 7, beginning in verse 14. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. And this is Paul talking as a Christian. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree with that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is a sin living within me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me. that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, I do. This I keep on doing." You see, as a Christian, sometimes we get caught in that whole idea of the struggle of continuing to sin, and how does that, you know, meet with our Christian life? You see, the struggle is not only that we have sin and we need it paid for, but once we become a Christian, we still struggle with that whole notion of sin. And Paul talks about that. It's overwhelming. It's a part of our nature. And how do we battle that nature? And he ends with the fulcrum scripture verse. And that scripture verse is 7:24. "What a wretched man am I. Who can deliver me from the power of sin? Who can deliver me from the body that is subject to death? Who can deliver me?" That's the question. That's the hopelessness. Even though I have had the great debt paid for me, I still struggle. John the Baptist asked Jesus a question. He was in prison. He was about to be beheaded. And he sends some of his disciples to Jesus, and the question is found in Matthew chapter 11. He says, "Are you the one to come, or should we expect someone else?" Jesus replied, "Go back and report to John what you see and hear. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor." One of the things that we have to understand when we read the New Testament, and I've mentioned it a few times as I've prayed benediction over the communion, is that the Jewish people expected the Messiah to bring two things. They expected the Messiah to bring judgment, and they expected the Messiah to bring life. The interesting thing about that is, as John the Baptist saw the life, he saw Jesus healing people, he saw Jesus raising the dead, he saw the life. His question was, "These awful, nasty Romans have got us down, and in fact, I'm in prison about to lose my head. Where is the judgment? Where is the judgment?" John 3:17 is a very interesting verse. "For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that through him they might be saved." He didn't come to judge us. He came to bring life. We have two people in the Gospel of Luke that had waited years and years and years and went to the temple every day because they had a promise. Luke 2:25. "Now there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel," that's Jesus, "and the Holy Spirit that he would not die, and the Holy Spirit said that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents of Jesus brought the child Jesus to do for him what was the custom the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, 'Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.'" He was ready to die. He'd seen everything that he wanted to see. He understood that this little baby who was being brought so that he might be circumcised on the seventh day, his parents so poor that they could only bring two doves that they captured. They didn't even have a lamb that they could offer as the law required. So poor. A little boy born to such hopelessness. And yet Simeon understood. A little bit later we have Anna. There was a prophet Anna, the daughter of Penuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, 7 years after marriage, and then was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple but worshiped day and night, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Israel. You see, even from the very beginning, people understood that Jesus was going to bring life. He was going to bring life into this world. You see, one of the greatest images of hopelessness is when the Savior of the world is dying on the cross. Dying that we might have our sins forgiven. Nothing more hopeless than that. And yet Jesus was raised from the dead. The scripture we read, that was read this morning, I'm going to read just a little bit more, but I'm going to start with verse 22. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in pains of childbirth right up to this present time. Not only so, but we ourselves. We have the first fruits of the Spirit. We ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption into sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we are saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. One of the interesting things about that section is, why do we have hurricanes? Why do we have earthquakes? Why do we have snowstorms? Romans seems to indicate that the very earth has been condemned in the fall, and it is waiting for redemption. Those things are part of the fall as well. The perfection was broken. Why do we have aches and pains? Why is it I can't stand more than 5 minutes at a time? I had a very quick wedding a month and a half ago. Part of the reason it was a quick wedding is because I was 10 minutes. I was right at the edge of my ability to stand. Why do we have aches and pains? Why do we have hurts and resentments? Probably the most challenging thing for anybody in my office is to let go of resentments. Parents who didn't do them right. Spouses who don't do them right. And they hold resentments. Children whose parents, they think, didn't do them right. We need deliverance to something better. But we're not defeated. We're not defeated. Why do we need to wait? I don't know that we do. A little farther in chapter 8 it says, "For your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, nor the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height or depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God." You see, no matter what happens in our life, we can't be separated from God. God holds us in his hands every single day. Where is our hope? Some of you who have been to men's group are going to hear some of what I'm about to say before, and I apologize. But the question, I think, that arises from all this can be found in John chapter 9. Jesus' disciples came to him and said, "Is it this man's sin or his parents' sin? Is that the reason he was born blind?" And Jesus' answer is really interesting. He said, "Neither. Neither. This man was born blind so that you might see the works of God displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. while I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. You see, when bad things happen, we get discouraged and we're hopeless. This verse tells me that's the very time we should have the most hope. Because this is the time we get to see God at work. And how many here would not like to see God at work? It's a special thing to see God at work. And yet I think we miss it because we're so hopeless. And good things happen and we miss it because we're so hopeless. When I was a pastor, right before I moved down here, I came down and met with a friend of mine, my business partner. And we looked around and, you know, checked things out. And I'd pretty much decided that I was going to move down here and help her start to practice. When I got home, it was first weekend, a friend of mine was at the house, and we were having dinner, and I had worked part-time as a chaplain, and actually I was not working there then, but I get a phone call from one of the nurses from the ER that knew me very well, and she said, Pastor Bill, she said, I really need you to get down here. And I'm like, okay. I said, what happened? And she said, a couple in our church, their two-year-old had gotten run over by a pickup truck and was killed. Okay. Wow. So I get to church, mom's outside just howling and screaming, and of course. And dad was just stunned. I mean, he was just stunned. And fortunately, I've been trained enough as a chaplain. I knew what to do and just really kind of, you know, did the things that needed to be done to kind of get the situation moving forward. And I traumatized one of the women in my church because I asked her to come along just to kind of expose her to being a good minister. And mom did something that just was unbelievable, and I won't share that here. Long story short, we was at the funeral, and mom was crying, and she came up to me and she said, Pastor, why did God allow this to happen? And I said, I have no idea. I really don't know. I mean, it's hopeless. I don't know. And I shared with her this passage of Scripture. And I also shared the one I just read. All things work together for the good of those who love the Lord, those who are called according to His purpose. I said, all I know is somehow in this, you're going to see God. If you just slow everything down, you're going to get to see God at work. That was in early October. My last Sunday was December 31st. I was, when we had a sort of a meet and greet time, so everybody could kind of get up and, you know, shake hands after a first song or two. And so I was just coming off of the altar area, and she came barreling down toward me, a big smile on her face. And I said, what's up? And she said, I saw Jesus. So really? I said, tell me about it. She said, you know, as I was being carried through this by God, carrying me through my pain, I was telling my friends about that. And she said, this person came to the Lord. This person came to the Lord. This couple came to the Lord. And she said, in all of this, I got to see God at work. And she was so, so excited about that at that moment. You see, bad and hopeless times are the very times when God can work. He doesn't work when times are good. I mean, He does, but it's nothing special. But when God can open the Red Sea so that 6 million people can escape, when it's the most hopeless, that's when God can work. When Absalom is ruling with a crazy iron fist, and David is running for his life, Absalom's long and flowing hair gets caught in a tree, and Joel gets to, Joel, starts with J, I'm sorry, I'm 63, I forget names, runs a sword through him and kills him. When it was hopeless, God provided a way out. When Jesus died on the cross and it was the most hopeless it could be, it was so hopeless that God had to turn His face away for a moment. 3 days later, He raised Him from the dead. You see, no matter what's going on in your life today, no matter how bad it is, Advent is a time for us to find hope. Because it's a time for us to slow everything down, not speed it up, slow everything down, and to really look at what Jesus is offering to us. And the first thing he's offering to us is hope. You see, there is a reason in the church calendar Christmas does not start until December 24th, and Christmas goes till January 6th. It's because we should not get caught up in that minutia until the 24th. It does not start now. Now is the time for us to focus on what Jesus can do in our lives. And it's a time for us to share that with other people. All of us know people who are without hope. All of us know those people. We can give them hope. We can introduce them to Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Advent is a time of hope. Hope for healing of the past. Hope for doing better today. Hope for a future that is built on the foundation of Jesus, who makes us more than conquerors. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you today that in the face of things that are extremely hopeless, we can find in you hope. And we would ask today that your Holy Spirit would just touch people's hearts and help them to understand that you have hope for them today. No matter how hopeless it seems, you can give them hope. Lord, we thank you today for your Son, for his willingness to die for us, and for his willingness to give us a hope that we would not have without him. We thank you for all that today, as we ask in your Son's name. Amen.
Thanks, Bill. You know, in the almost 15 years that Northside's been in existence, there's been a handful of occasions that the church has experienced situations where, as a pastor, I thought, I don't know how we're going to survive this. One of those was not being able to meet in a building and having to meet out on a loading dock one Sunday. And I remember looking out at my mom, and some of you I've told this story, and my mom was in tears, and I think she felt the same thing I did, that this is how the church is going to end, like right here. And I'm so thankful for the people that God put in our lives. And you have these people, and maybe you are one of these people, that come and in the midst of hopeless situations, speak hope to you. For me, that was a younger brother who reminded me that now, just as Bill said, now is the time that you get to see God do something amazing, because it's no longer in our control. There's nothing else we can do about it. And every time, God has shown up. If you're here this morning and you're in one of those situations where things are hopeless for you, I hope you know two things. I hope you know, number one, God will show up. And number two, that's exactly why he's given you the church, so that you do not have to walk through this alone. And for those of you who God has given you the gift of encouragement, let me tell you something. You may never realize the words of hope that you speak to people and how 10 years later, they still look at them as Ebenezers, as monuments of God's faithfulness, things that were said that got them through dark nights in their soul and repositioned them to see that we do serve a God who brings hope. You're here this morning and you don't understand what that relationship with Christ is like, I would love to tell you about someone who can transcend anything this world can offer you and give you hope. If you're here this morning and there's people in your life who are hurting, and you're hoping that in some way hope is going to find them, then maybe we should pray. Whatever your need is, whatever your concerns are, we're going to the Lord as a response to His Word. And may we do so believing that the very one we're praying to is able to bring us hope. Would you stand and we'll sing together.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but holding the trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, the cornerstone, the weak made strong, and the Savior. Love, and through the storm, He is Lord, the Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace.
Church said, amen. I invite you to be seated.
This morning we've come to a time in our service where we take up our tithes and offerings. If you're visiting with us today, I hope that you will not feel any obligation to contribute. We want today to be a gift to you. And if you are visiting with us, now would be the time to drop that connect card in the offering bag as it passes you by. Or if you have any prayer concerns, you could certainly share those with us and we'll be
keeping those in our prayers in the coming weeks. There's going to be a Bible study starting Wednesday night, and while the offering is being taken, we're going to show you a video of what this four-week study is going to be about. But before we do that, I'm going to ask one of our deacons, Richie Nairn, if he will, to ask for God's blessing on the tithes and offerings. Richie. That study begins this Wednesday night. It's 4 weeks looking at the Advent conspiracy. Would love for you to come out. We'll be meeting here in the sanctuary at 7 o'clock. It'll end each Wednesday night by 8:30 or so. Want to share a couple of announcements with you before we head out. A big thank you to everyone who helped out with two big things that were going on in the church. One of them was Operation Christmas Child. You guys, every year, you surpass the goal, and this year, over 150 boxes are going all over the world to kids who, this might be the very first Christmas they actually received something. And so I really want to thank you for being a part of that. And then for those of you that prayed, supported, served at the Thanksgiving Day outreach, really appreciate that as well. It's really neat to see all of these different things becoming traditions here in the church, things that are really touching people's lives. A couple other things to share with you before we dismiss this morning, and two of them have to do with connection. The first is, if you have a child that you would like to present for dedication, December 11th, we're going to be doing that at the 10:45 service. And so if that's something you've never done before, or you have questions about it, please find me after the service, and we will certainly talk about it and get you connected to doing that if that's a decision you want to make. And the second one is something new we're doing this year. If you walk out, you're going to look to your left, and you're going to see a Christmas tree. And every year, there's ornaments on it, and every year, I don't know if people pay attention to the ornaments that are on there. And so a couple of days ago, when Mitch and I were setting up the Christmas tree, we decided that we were going to do something a little different this year. We were not going to put anything on it. And instead, we were going to let you decorate the tree. And so there are tags out there. And what my hope is that you will write something that you're praying for, something that maybe you're hoping for in this coming year. And it looks like a tag that you would find on a present. Write it down. Put a hook on it. They're out there. Put it on the tree. And know that we're going to be praying for it and hoping that whatever it is you're hoping for, whatever it is you're praying for, there's going to be people praying with you and hoping with you in that. I hope it's been good to be gathered as the church this morning. I hope that you will come and let Bill know how the Lord spoke to him, how he encouraged you. And with Christmas upon us, it's here, guys. It's here. There's a lot of opportunities to connect, a lot of ways to serve, a lot of ways to make this about worship and not about all the things this world tells us it has to be about. I hope you'll jump in. Would you stand, and I'm going to leave you with this benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. And all of God's people said, amen. God bless you all. Have a great week, everyone.